speaker, Sarah Simone. She is a Wilson Fellow at Fermilab, and her work is in cosmology. She focuses on understanding fundamental science governing our universe. And she specializes in designing and developing the telescope that observes the first light from the universe. She began studying cosmology as an undergrad at the University of Colorado, where she received her dual degree in physics and astrophysics. She earned her PhD in physics at Princeton University, where she had a NASA Science Technology Research Fellowship. And she did her postdoctoral work at University of Michigan. She works on a number of cosmology experiments, including Atacama Cosmology Telescope, Simons Observatory, CMB-S4, and Toltec. So welcome to the speakers. If everyone can mute their audio and video, and we'll take the questions till the at the end of the talk. And Sarah, you can take it away.
Great. Let's get this set up. All right, so thanks for that introduction and to all of you for being here today. I'm really excited to share some of the science and technology that I really love with you today. Of course, I didn't always know that I wanted to study cosmology, but I was initially really drawn to physics because it was really trying to answer the most fundamental questions in science. And so I tried out a few areas of research, including solar physics, but I kept being drawn back to these really, really big questions. And that's ultimately what really led me into cosmology. Now, cosmology is the study of the beginning and the evolution of the universe. It answers some of the largest questions we have about our universe, including what it's made up of, what happened shortly after its beginning, and what will happen to it as it goes toward the future. How has its behavior changed and evolved over time? And so really, this is a core of the information that we're trying to get at with all of these really amazing experiments. So looking at what the universe is made up of, we only interact with something like 4.6% of our universe. Dark energy, which is the largest portion of our universe, is actually causing the universe to expand more and more quickly as time goes on. And dark matter is acting like regular matter and interacting gravitationally, except that it doesn't interact with light. And so we don't know what causes dark matter and dark energy and what they're made up of. So we really only understand kind of 4.6% of our universe. So we're really trying to better understand these quantities. So with lambda, our current model of the universe is the lambda CDM model of cosmology. It says we live in an expanding flat universe that began in a hot dense state, and that universe is dominated by dark energy, which is that lambda, and then cold dark matter, which is the CDM. Now, if we look at the evolution of the universe, it's really a story of expanding and cooling over time. Very early on in the universe, we have this really hot plasma, and it's very tightly coupled to light. And what's happening is there's these slight density perturbations. And so gravity around these perturbations is pulling things in. And as they heat up, as they get pulled in, they then get pushed out. And so they're kind of oscillating around these slight density perturbations. Now, eventually, the universe cools and expands enough for that light to decouple from that plasma as the first atoms begin to form. And when it decouples, it actually carries all of that information about those oscillations in it. And this light is the cosmic microwave background. And it's formed only about 400,000 years after the universe began, which is very, very early on. Now, after this, gravity goes to work. Things coalesce into larger and larger structures. We have enough material come in to form the first stars, which reignite the universe. And then we have them kind of collect into larger and larger structures. Galaxies form, and then we have galaxies cluster together. And so if we look at our universe today, we actually measure that it's expanding, and that tells us the amount of dark energy and that it's really the dominant thing in our universe right now. And then if we look at all the structure that's formed in the universe, all these galaxies and galaxy clusters, we would see a lot less formed today if dark matter didn't exist. And so that's our big clue that there is dark matter as well. Now, this Lambda CDM model describes our universe incredibly well, and it does it with only 6 parameters, but it leaves a lot of fundamental questions in our universe unanswered. And so the cosmic microwave background, which is that afterglow of the Big Bang, it formed only 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And so it's the oldest light in the universe. And it's also the most prevalent. If you add up all the energy from all the light in the universe, the CMB would make up more than 90% of it. And we get two things from the cosmic microwave background. As I said, it's a snapshot of the early universe. So it's really a picture of the earliest moments of the universe and how things are interacting. And just to kind of gauge the energy scales here, it's 10 trillion times the energies we can reach with particle accelerators today. So we can actually learn a lot about high energy physics as well. The second thing it gives us is it's a backlight to the formation and evolution of structure in the universe. So it formed very early on, and then we have all these galaxies and galaxy clusters coming together. And because of that, we can use it as this backlight to that formation. And that gives us information about how dark matter and dark energy are affecting how structure comes together. It gives us information about particles and their interactions, because some particles would inhibit structure from coming together. And it also gives us information about astrophysics. We can learn about these larger structures in our universe. So when we look at the light from the cosmic microwave background, it really has two main types of information. There's the temperature, which is giving us the energy of the light. And then there's its polarization. Now, polarization is the orientation of the electric field in the light wave. So a usual light wave has its magnetic field and its electric field, and it would be propagating this way in this picture. And the polarization direction is along this electric field. So it would be just kind of around that direction. So it's basically what direction it's oscillating in. And you can kind of draw a parallel with this to your polarized sunglasses. So in this picture, the orientations drawn are all of their electric field orientations. And so it blocks the electric field oscillating kind of parallel to the surface of the road. So you eliminate the glare and let the other light through your glasses. So what we're looking at when we're looking at the CMB is information in both this temperature and its polarization. Now, inflation is currently the leading theory of the early universe. It says that the universe underwent an exponential expansion shortly after it began. And this actually offers explanations for several unexplained phenomena. Our universe is really flat geometrically when we look at it today. Flatness tends to go away really quickly. When you have any curvature, it tends to get much larger really quickly in time. So the fact that we're flat today must mean that we were extremely flat in the early universe. It also explains the uniformity of the universe, because when we look at the sky, if we look at a patch, to the right and to the left, there should be casually disconnected because it's 13.7 billion years each way. So they should have never touched. But if there was this period of really exponential expansion, they could have been in contact in the early universe and then been blown up to these size scales. It also gives us an explanation for why there is structure in the universe. We don't know what caused those initial density perturbations, but with inflation, it comes from quantum fluctuations, which are these very, very tiny fluctuations, but with inflation, they get blown up to cosmic scales. So that kind of seeds all of the structure in our universe. Now, if inflation occurred, it would have left a signature pattern in the CMB. And we call that the B-mode polarization. And it kind of has these curly patterns around hot and cold spots in the cosmic microwave background. So we're kind of looking for this signature pattern. And the size of this signal would actually measure the energy scale of this expansion, which could help us differentiate between many different models of the early universe that exist. So it's also one of the most exciting things about it is it's one of the few ways we can probe the early universe 10 to the negative 36 seconds after its beginning. There's almost no other way to probe so early in the universe's history. So this has really just spawned a worldwide effort to try and measure this signal. Now, CMB also acts as a backlight. So in this scenario, photons from the CMB right here are gravitationally deflected by all of the structure between that's formed between when the CMB formed and when we're looking at it. So that's all of this purple structure here. And so it gets gravitationally deflected by this structure. And we can actually use that to map out the dark matter on the sky. And you know, that really helps us probe this growth of structure and get information about how dark energy is affecting structure, as well as those particle interactions. For example, neutrinos are relativistic, and so they would apply a pressure and inhibit structure formation. So some people think there might be a fourth type of neutrino. And so if that did exist, it would have inhibited structure formation. And we can actually measure those types of quantities. And so this is a really faint signal on these small scales, but I'm gonna flip between these two slides in a moment. But basically, I'm showing in this background the cosmic microwave background without any of this structure and with the structure. And so you can see, if it lets me flip between these, you can see that it's a very, very small signal, but we can measure that incredibly well and actually map out that dark matter distribution on the sky. We can also use the cosmic microwave background as a backlight to study galaxy clusters. So galaxy clusters are these large structures in the universe where hundreds of galaxies come together. And they're the largest structures in the universe, and they formed relatively recently on cosmic timescales. So it means that they're very highly sensitive to the effects of dark matter and dark energy on structure formation. And so clusters are basically made up of these many galaxies. So in this image from Hubble here in the optical of this galaxy cluster, you can see all these different galaxies around here. But then most of the mass is actually in this huge amount of hot gas. And you can actually see that when you go to the X-ray. This is the same cluster, and you can see there's just this huge amount of hot gas. And so with the CMB, these photons from the CMB are really low energy, and they come in and they hit this high energy gas in the galaxy clusters, and it boosts their energy up to higher energies, which corresponds to higher frequencies. So if we're looking at our signal at 150 gigahertz, where the cosmic microwave background has the most signal, we actually see that we lose some signal because it's been boosted up to these higher energies. So they show up as little kind of cold spots in our maps. And the really, really cool thing about using the CMB as a backlight is that the signal doesn't dim with distance. Usually if you're looking in X-ray or optical, the further away things get, the harder it is to see them. But with the cosmic microwave background, it's a backlight. So the light isn't dimming as you get further away. So you can actually get a much clearer picture of this evolution of the structure over time. Now, we can't just go buy some things and go look at the CMB. To measure the CMB, we actually have to build specialized telescopes because nothing else is really looking at these wavelengths of light. So here's the whole spectrum of light. Here's our visible part of the spectrum. It's only a small fraction of what there is to observe. And we're looking in the microwaves. Now the CMB has kind of millimeter wavelengths, which corresponds to gigahertz frequencies. So we have to make telescopes that can look at these frequencies. So really our telescopes are like video cameras. We have lenses and optics that focus light onto pixels. And one of the things that we do is that the atmosphere is constantly moving. This is a simulation of it over time and temperature. And you can see it's constantly moving. And we also want to observe really large areas of the sky. So instead of taking still images, we actually scan across patches of the sky and record the signals as we do. And so that is really the data that we're collecting in our observations. And unlike kind of optical telescopes, we can observe during both the day and the night. So we're kind of always running science observations. Now, once we have all those observations, we patch them together to make maps of the CMB across the sky. And we make maps of both the temperature and the polarization. You can see an example of that below from Planck here. They have the temperature being the color. So there's hotter areas and colder areas after you subtract the average temperature of the cosmic microwave background. And all these kind of hairy features here are the polarization orientations of the light. So they're mapping both the temperature and the polarization. And from these maps, we can really just extract all of our scientific information. And so these are kind of the end goal that we want to get when we're done with our observations. So we have a couple of problems that come into play when we want to make these really sensitive observations. So the first is that water in the atmosphere interacts with microwaves. And this is actually how your microwave at home heats up food. Microwaves are absorbed by water molecules and then they re-emit them. But when they get absorbed, the water molecules jostle around more and more because they've gotten this extra energy, and that's actually the heat in your food. And so the atmosphere is constantly changing and it's creating noise in our measurements. And so, you know, ideally we would just go to space where there isn't an atmosphere, but it's really expensive. And to do, you know, some of these larger projects where we have these kind of really large dishes, it's just not feasible. And so we focus on ground-based observations. And most of our telescopes right now are based in the Atacama Desert in Chile and the South Pole. And we choose these locations because they're high altitude, so there's less atmosphere overall to look through. In the Atacama, we're based at about 17,000 feet. And I think the effective atmosphere elevation at the South Pole is around 11 to 12,000 feet elevation. So we're really high up. And we're also in some of the driest places on Earth to minimize the water in the atmosphere. So both the Atacama Desert and the South Pole are deserts. So they're incredibly dry. And I'm gonna show on the next slide kind of a flyover of one of these sites in the Atacama. So this is the Atacama Cosmology Telescope. And you can't actually see the telescope here, but we'll be able to see it in the video because we have this screen kind of keep the ground from interfering with our signal. So let's just go ahead and look at that. So this is a drone flyover. So this is the landscape. And then we're coming up on the area where we're looking at. So there's the Atacama Cosmology Telescope. You can see the telescope in there now. This is the whole site area. And then you can see the telescope. This is a roughly 20 meter dish, or a 20 foot dish, 6 meter. And you can see some of our scientists up there. And then that does focus light onto this camera inside the telescope. And so in this video, they're taking that camera out because we're going to upgrade that camera. And then we go through and once we have that, we can actually just observe in both day and night. Another challenge that we run into is that the Milky Way actually blocks our view. It has a lot of stuff in it. It has thermal dust, which emits in the microwave. And it also has synchrotron radiation from these particles spinning around magnetic field lines. And this can actually cause false signals that contaminate our measurements. They can actually create polarized signals that mimic this inflationary B mode signal that we're looking for. So you can get a false detection if we don't properly remove that. And that's in fact what happened a few years ago. You might've heard, oh, we found inflationary B modes, and then people had to walk it back because they realized it was just this foreground contamination from our Milky Way. And the contamination that the Milky Way makes, we call foreground contamination. And so mostly for our inflationary B mode measurements, we observe only the cleanest patches. So we'll observe where, you know, the signal is smaller. So kind of down here and up here. And then the other trick we can use is that if we look at the signal as a function of frequency, the different signals from synchrotron and dust in the cosmic microwave background have different shapes with frequency. So you can see the dust signal gets more intense at higher frequencies. The synchrotron gets more intense at lower frequencies. And we have a completely different shape for the cosmic microwave background. And so if we can actually observe at many different frequencies, we can actually characterize and remove these signals and really get at that cosmic microwave background signal that we want to focus on. The final really huge thing is that the signals we want to measure are incredibly small. So if you think of these in terms of temperature, room temperature is something like 298 Kelvin. When we look at the atmosphere, it's 5 to 20 Kelvin. And the average temperature of the cosmic microwave background is 2.73 Kelvin. But this inflationary B mode signal that we're looking for is less than 100 times 10 to the 9 Kelvin. So this is a very, very tiny signal. So we need to have highly sensitive cameras to be able to measure these signals. So we do that through a couple of ways. First thing we want to do is to not lose any light in our telescope. So we try and increase the amount of light that reaches our pixels through all of our lenses and filters. And then we want to cool our telescopes down. Again, when there's a lot of molecules bustling around, that's heat. And that can cause noise. So we cool our optics down to something like 4 to 100 Kelvin, and we cool our pixels down to 100 millikelvin. So that's just fractions of a degree above absolute zero. So we have our telescopes are some of the coolest places in the universe in more ways than one. And we also, to get at the signal, have to have highly sensitive pixels in our camera that have low noise. And we have to have many, many pixels so we can average down that noise. So when we look to design the telescopes to make these measurements, we actually need different telescope designs for different goals. So for the inflationary B modes, we want really deep measurements on these smaller, clearer patches of the sky. The signal we're looking for kind of peaks on degree scales, so we don't need much resolution. We only need about half a degree resolution, which is about the size of the moon on the sky. So we don't need to hone in very much. And so for these, we use many half meter or 1.6 foot refractive telescopes. And that just means that there's no mirrors, it's just lenses kind of focusing the light onto our pixels. And then for all of the structure formation, dark matter, dark energy, and particle interactions, we wanna see these kind of smaller structures in the universe. And so for that, we want high resolution and we want one arc minute, which is 1/60th of a degree resolution. And we wanna observe that on large areas of the sky. And so we make these big telescopes with 6 meter or roughly 20 foot mirrors, like the one you saw in the video. This design has light entering through here, going off of one of these 6 meter mirrors onto another 6 meter mirror and focusing into our camera. So if we look at these in a little bit more detail, you can see that they're very similar to digital cameras. We fully enclose it in a cryostat to keep things cool, but then we just have three lenses focusing light onto our pixels. And here our lenses are actually made of silicon versus glass. Now silicon looks black to the eye, but it's transparent to microwaves. And then for our high resolution telescopes, light comes in here, goes off our 6 meter mirrors and goes into this camera or what we call a receiver. And so this has many different optics tubes or individual cameras inside of it. And each optics tube, again, has kind of three lenses focusing the light onto the pixels. So they're very similar optics designs, but they're very tuned to the specific goals that we want to achieve. Now, after light goes through and gets focused kind of on our pixels, there's a final step of focusing the light from the lenses onto the pixels themselves. And we really want to collect the maximum amount of light and focus it only on the part of the pixel that's sensitive to light, because the whole pixel isn't sensitive. And so you can kind of see a little bit of that in the picture here. There's this little circle here that's the sensitive part of the detector. And we have this big, what we call a feed horn here. And I like to think of them as funnels for light. So it's going from this larger radius down to the small one. So it's basically funneling and focusing the light just right onto our detectors. And you can see a full array of that, where each individual one looks like this. And I get excited about this one because I actually am the person who gets to design and make these feed horns, and I actually have some samples that I'll show you at the end of the talk. Now, I've said a couple of times that we need to have highly sensitive pixels to measure these really faint signals. So this is what a single pixel looks like. And each pixel has four detectors on it. So we have two frequencies on each pixel, and each of those frequencies has two different polarizations that we measure. Now we're looking at millimeter wavelengths of light. So our detectors are millimeters big. So this detector is 5.3 millimeters. And you can see it's taken in relation to a dime here. So this is a dime in the background. So they're pretty small. I mean, the millimeter features are relatively big compared to optical light, but all these features on the pixel are incredibly small. So we actually fabricate these largely at national labs with nanofabrication facilities, kind of like the chips in your electronics. And so this is a single pixel, and then we put them in these arrays of something like 432 pixels. So you can see the array, full array right here. Now, if we zoom in on one of these pixels, we can kind of see how they work. So again, the light is coming in and kind of hitting this circle. And in this circle, we have two different types of fins. So there's a fin oriented in this direction, where light with that electric field oscillating in this direction couples here, and light oscillating in this direction couples here. So we get two polarizations separated by 90 degrees. Light then goes through these lines, which are superconducting, so we don't lose any signal to our resistance. So that means they have zero resistance. And then it kind of splits at this T, and you can see that there's kind of two different sizes here, and that's because we're looking at two different frequencies of light or two different wavelengths. So these are the low frequency or large wavelength light, and these are for the high frequency. So high frequency light goes this way and low frequency light goes this way. And then those get routed onto these individual detectors where we transition to gold, which doesn't superconduct. So we basically dump all of the power onto our detectors right here. Now our detectors actually use the properties of superconductors to make a super sensitive detector. So with superconductors, they behave normally above a certain temperature, so kind of flat with temperature in their resistance. And then at some point they go to zero resistance. And in between these two points, there's a really sharp transition between temperature and resistance. And so we actually try and take advantage of that. So we make our detectors out of superconductors and we bias them right in the middle here. We keep them in this part of the transition so that when there's a small temperature change in the light coming in, it gets amplified. So we amplify all these small signals from the cosmic microwave background coming in. And you know, these are so sensitive that we're roughly at the limit of how sensitive a detector can actually be. And so the only thing left to do to make a more sensitive instrument is really to add more and more detectors. And so this is kind of showing how we're scaling things up. So Advanced ACTPL is currently observing in Chile. It's the telescope that we saw in that flyover video. And it had kind of four of these wafers, or roughly 5,000 detectors, and it had one of these big telescopes. Now, Simons Observatory is going to start observing in the next couple of years, and they are scaling up by a factor of 10 to 50,000 detectors. They'll have one of these large telescopes, and then three of the smaller inflationary beam mode telescopes. And then CMBS-4, which Fermilab is working on, is going to field within the next decade. And it's scaling up by another factor of 10 to something like 500,000 detectors. We'll have three of these large telescopes and 18 of these small telescopes. So we're really just scaling up by factors of 10. And so compared to today, we're going to have to scale up by about a factor of 100 here, which is huge. And so we really need to make huge leaps in scalability for CMBS-4. So one of the things we have to do is explore new techniques for making components. One example of that, again, is the feed horns. So we used to have to make them out of these silicon wafers. We had stack up like 40 of these wafers and make sure they got the individual holes etched in them. And that took several weeks to make a single array like this. And now with these new aluminum feed horns, which you see an example of one being drilled right here, you can see how fast we're drilling those in. It takes about a day to make one of these now. So we've really just cutting down the time it takes to make things. We also need to have faster testing and verification. So you need to make sure that everything we're making actually works. So we need to make detectors that are uniform and make sure that they're behaving as we would expect them to. And so we need to test over 500 detector arrays, and Fermilab is really leading the effort of this integrated testing. Now, these are really just huge projects, and achieving these science goals really requires full teams of scientists, engineers, technicians, and support staff from all around the world. So this is really a global effort to try and figure out this fundamental science. Now, we can't reach all of our science goals with only sensitivity. So CMBS-4 is gonna have unmatched sensitivity. It'll be the most sensitive experiment we've ever made. But as we become more sensitive to the CMB, we also become more sensitive to false signals caused by our telescopes in the environments that they're in. So really going forward, we need a deep understanding of our telescopes to be able to separate their effects from the cosmic microwave background signal. And so we need to make improved simulations of effects to help guide the design. So here's an example of us coding up and simulating a full kind of focal plane with seven of these different arrays. Those are the same kind of hexagonal arrays that we've seen throughout with 432 pixels. You can see there's little crosses for their polarization. And so we can basically build up this instrument model and then simulate the signals that we expect to see and see what types of signals we should be looking for when we take data to make sure that what we're seeing is really the CMB. We also need to measure and understand our telescope's performance. We can't simulate everything perfectly. And so we need to actually take really good measurements of the telescope itself to understand how it's working. So we can make sure, again, that we're separating the effects of the telescope from the cosmic microwave background. So every aspect of these designs really has to be very, very carefully vetted. So when we're designing the instrument and making instrument design decisions, we have to ask, do our instrument designs meet the requirements so that we can reach our science goals? And, you know, what design changes are the most impactful? You know, maybe it costs several million dollars to get 1% sensitivity in the detectors, but you can get 10% for that price if you change the optics a bit. So it's really an optimization problem when we're designing these telescopes. And then we have to also make plans for how we measure our telescopes or calibrate them. So we need to say how well we need to measure our telescopes. We need to figure out what tools we need to measure our telescopes with. Here's some examples of some of the tools that we use to calibrate. And we also need to know how well we have to understand those tools and whatever systematic effects they may have. And then we also have to figure out how often we need to measure our telescopes with these tools. Ideally, you would measure your telescopes for a long time with these tools so you could really understand your telescope, but you're competing with the time that you would be observing on the sky. So we want to spend the maximum time observing the sky and not waste extra time using these calibrators, but we need to observe it enough that we know enough about our telescopes. So this is a really tricky problem that we've been working on tackling. So really the next generation of observations are poised to make these huge discoveries about the fundamental physics of the universe. There's been two Nobel Prizes on the cosmic microwave background. The first was for figuring out that it, for detecting it and finding out that it existed. And then the second was for finding those small temperature variations after you subtract the mean. And so we're really kind of on the precipice of really new physics that's just incredibly exciting. We can answer, you know, did inflation occur? And we'll get all these new insights into the mysteries of dark energy, dark matter, particle interactions, and structure formation. So we're really going to find some really amazing science. But to really advance the science, we need advances in the technology and the production of our telescopes. And that's what a lot of people are working on right now. And CMBS-4 is gonna be a state-of-the-art observatory that's on the forefront of these next generation observations. And so that's what I have. I have the samples if people would want to see those. So this is a single feed horn. So you can see it goes, it's basically that same funnel shape. And so it's about this big. And then you can make a full array of those. And so those arrays are kind of like 6 inches wide. So they're not very big. So you can see the big side funneling down to that smaller side. And we get a bunch of these together and lock them together in a bunch of hexagons. So that's the cool science that I get to make.
Awesome. Thank you very much for such a nice talk. So if you have any questions, let me see in the chat. Okay, so Jacob Schaffer asks, what parameters do you have to consider when designing feed horns?
Yeah, so when you design feed horns, you want the optics to look nice. So you don't want to have a beam that looks squished. You want like a nice circular Gaussian beam. So you want to make sure that their electromagnetic properties look nice. And then you basically want to make sure they're collecting as much light as possible because we don't want to waste any light.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So next, Charles Libano has a question. You mentioned neutrinos. What is progress of DUNE with Fermilab and Sanford Lab? Also, could the findings from DUNE affect aforementioned theory of inflation?
So I don't know much about the status of DUNE. I know that they're actively working to build it right now, which is really exciting. And I think the really cool thing about that project is that it's complementary to what we look for. They're looking for neutrinos changing from one type into another, which can tell you the difference in mass between neutrinos. Whereas what we're looking for is the overall mass. So we can say, hey, the overall mass is this. And then they say, oh, these are the masses of each of them because we measure the differences. And so they actually go really well together.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next question we have from Phil. What do you expect the new telescope to, when do you expect the new telescope to start collecting science data?
So nominally right now we're planning for 2027 for CMBS-4. Whether that has been pushed back a little bit from COVID or not is not entirely clear yet, but we're kind of around the late 2020s is where we're aiming right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Alexander has a question. How big is the difference in price if you want to send the telescope to space compared to having them on the surface of the Earth?
Okay, yeah, so for like CMBS-4, where we have like 18 small telescopes plus three, it's kind of on order $1 billion, where if you wanted to send one small telescope to space, that would be about $1 billion. So it's a huge price difference.
Yeah. Okay, next question. We have getting a lot of questions. That's awesome. So Michelle has a question. Why do you make hexagon instead of other shapes?
Yeah, so the cool thing about hexagons is that they're approximately circular shapes. So all of our beams are circular. So we want something that fits in a circle pretty well. And when you tile them together, there's no space wasted between them. Like if you did circles, you'd have all these circles. You can actually see on here the circles, there's some space that you're wasting in between. And so if you tile all the hexagons together, you waste a lot less space. So it's the best way to pack things in. And actually bees found that out too, because you see honeycomb is in that shape.
Wow, that's very interesting. Okay, so next question. Lavanya has a question. How is CMB from today used for predicting the life of the universe, which happened billions of years ago?
Used for predicting the light or the life?
Life of the universe.
Yeah, so basically the CMB is this like kind of baby picture of the universe. And so we can actually, it's like directly measuring the light from the beginning of the universe. And so that's how we can measure stuff very early on. And so it's basically, you know, this light is 13.7 billion years old and it's traveled all the way to get to us. So that's how we can tell that it's directly from the beginning.
Mm-hmm. Amrita has a question. Hi, if universe started with explosion, would it be possible for cosmologists to find a central point of the universe where explosion started from a ground observatory on Earth? Thank you.
Yeah, so the tricky thing is the universe doesn't have a center. So it's infinite in all directions, which is kind of crazy to think about. And so we can't pinpoint a center because even when it's smaller, it's still infinite. And so anywhere you are, you would see kind of the same infinite sky.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next, Eric has a question. Where will the new telescope be located? Are there any plans for more space-based telescope?
Yeah, so the new telescope is going to be actually split between the South Pole and Chile. So in the South Pole, you can't see the whole sky, but you can see this nice clean patch. So we'll put kind of the inflationary telescopes down there. And then back up in Chile, we'll put those large aperture telescopes, the ones looking at large scales on the sky, because it's mid-latitude, so you can see most of the sky. So that's where we'll put those. So we're kind of actually splitting between two places, which we've never done before, which is really exciting. And then what was the second part?
Are there any plans for more space-based telescopes?
Yeah, so actually there's so you can really only do inflationary searches with telescopes right now because of the cost. So there's a small telescope that NASA is working on with JAXA I don't know if it's been approved or not, but it would be called Lightbird, and that would be kind of looking for the inflationary B-mode signal too.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. And Regina has a question. Why does telescope use silicon lenses rather than glass lenses?
Yeah, so for our wavelengths, silicon bends the light just right, so we can make a nice compact optics design, because we want to make the lens not too thick, because if we make a thick lens, then that means that we are going to be losing photons. So the thinner the lens, the better. And with silicon, it has a high refractive index, so it can actually make a thin lens that bends our light the same amount as like a really thick lens of another material might. And for our wavelengths, you can actually see through silicon, so it's not not like a solid piece or anything for us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next, Flavio has a question. Once we get spooled up on the moon, would that be a good place for your telescope? I don't know, what does, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if there was a base on the moon, that could be a good location, because there's no atmosphere. But again, you know, getting stuff up to that would be tricky. But, you know, we always dream about having kind of these cool new observatories. Right now, most of the stuff gets launched to kind of a stable point far away from Earth. And from there, they can actually see the whole sky, whereas on the moon, you would maybe see a little bit less because the ground of the moon is blocking your view in some of those areas.
This is not a question, but Soros has a comment. He says, thank you for your time.
You're welcome.
next, this is a question sent by email. How far can telescopes see? How big was Hubble? This was a question from Emmett, who is a seven-year-old kid.
Yeah, so I don't really remember the sizes of Hubble too well. It's kind of, I think, few meters, but I don't have the exact numbers. But what was the first part of the question again?
The first part of question was, how far can telescopes see?
Yeah, so how far you can see depends on what type of light you're looking at. So distance is time. And so if you're looking at really old light, like the cosmic microwave background, you can actually see 13.8 billion years ago. Whereas if you're looking at something that's closer, you know, that light isn't as old. And so we can actually, you know, when things get really far away, it gets a little hard to see them. But that's again why we like the cosmic microwave background, because it's this light that we can see from very early on, and we can actually use it to kind of find the shadows of the things that we can't see in optical or other wavelengths of light.
Mm-hmm. So next, Alexander has a question. You mentioned that universe is pretty flat. Does it mean that planets and stars are aligned in a way that there is almost zero difference in their position by one of the axes? If so, why do you think it happens and bodies don't rotate in all directions?
Yeah, so by flat, we actually mean space-time, so kind of 4D space-time, so all the directions plus time. And basically what that means, like if you had a sphere, right, and you drew a triangle on it, the angles between that triangle would not add up to 180 degrees, it'd be bigger. But basically it means that the topology of our time, of our space is such that if you added up all the angles, it would be 180 degrees. So it's not necessarily that things aren't rotating in different ways, because they are, it's basically just a geometric description of the space-time in the universe.
Mm-hmm. Next, David has a question. Do the Chilean telescopes scan the same patch as at the pole? Will S4 continue focus on that patch or somewhere else?
Yeah, so there's only a few clean patches. And so when you're looking for inflationary B-modes, you definitely look at very close to the same patch, if not the same patch. As I said, the pole is really limited in what they can see. So if this is kind of like the globe, they can only see like, you know, some percent of it. Whereas from Chile, you can see a large portion of the sky. And so in Chile, when we have the telescopes there, we're looking at that whole portion of the sky. And then at the pole, they're looking at the smaller patches, just because of what's available to look at.
Next, Barbara has a question. What entities are involved in funding the telescope? I know you mentioned NASA, but are there others?
Yeah, so NASA does mostly the space missions. And then the rest of the funding kind of comes from the National Science Foundation and the Department of Energy. And so for us, it's actually a joint project. So we have both funding from the NSF, but also from the Department of Energy, which is what allows all of us in the national labs to be working on such an exciting experiment.
Okay, next, Lavanya has a question. How has it proved that universe is expanding? Was it based on telescope observation? Thank you.
Yeah, so it was based on telescope observations. And so we actually measure, we're actually able to measure the speed of the expansion in the universe today. And it's expanding today, which means in the future, it will still be expanding. And with the cosmic microwave background, you can actually measure the percentages of how much dark energy there is, for example, based on that rate of expansion. So it's really cool that we can measure all these things just with kind of the expansion of the universe and this afterglow of its beginning.
Next, we have a question from Mayan. Is Fermilab partnered with NASA? If so, what have you guys done so far with NASA? And what's the plan in the future?
So we're not partnered right now on any projects with NASA, but we all kind of interact with people who are working on the same thing. So it's like people are working on Lightbird. Some of those same people are working on our telescopes too. But we're primarily a Department of Energy at Fermilab.
Next, Amrita has a question. If there are only few clean patches to observe, are there any countries trying to lay claim on those spots? Also, are there any diplomatic difficulties in setting up lab in other countries?
So far, we've been really good. In Chile, there's a requirement that you let scientists from Chile use your telescope too, but we have several Chilean collaborators, so that has not been an issue. And we also do a lot of local outreach in the area. And then in the South Pole, it's actually kind of already there. It's kind of this community of people from many parts of the world coming together. And so right now, there haven't been any difficulties. As we look for other places to put telescopes, we're actually really wary of the impact that has on local communities. And so we always like to partner with communities on our projects to make sure that we're not, ruining their culture or something like that. We like to be very careful with that. But the places that our telescopes go, there's already a lot of observatories, like up by where we are, there's ALMA, and we work a lot with the local community on that. And then as far as people laying claim to things, that has not been an issue either, because, where you are in the world determines what part of the sky you can see, but there's nothing blocking your view, really.
Next, Holly has a question. Is there a telescope or any experiment on the International Space Station studying this as well?
Yeah, so nothing on the International Space Station. I think all of our stuff is too big to get up there.
Okay, I think that's all the questions on the chat. I had like a question. It's like in two parts. Which is your favorite telescope, which is currently taking data, and which is in the past?
Okay, so one currently taking data is the Atacama Cosmology Telescope, and I really like that because that's the first telescope I helped build. So that was really exciting, and they've been taking data for a few years now, and we just released some more data. But they're on the sky right now. And then a little project that I worked on as a graduate student was called the Atacama B-Mode Search, or ABS. And it was kind of just a couple of people working on something. Our groups now are kind of like 500 people working on a project, but this had kind of like 10. So you could really get your hands in at every part of that, but it was a much smaller project, much less ambitious goals, but it was a really fun project because we got to really learn and really have our hands on every part of the telescope.
Mm-hmm. I think we have, will the video be available to view later? I think the video has been recorded. I think it should be available. Okay. Thank you for the speakers. I don't see any more questions here. I think we can move on to the next event. So next event is virtual tour from Dawn Cubics.
Hi, this is Donna. So I'm sharing my screen. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you well.
Okay. Okay, and you can see my screen also, correct? Yep.
We can see the screen.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Good afternoon. And I'm going to tell you about SIDET, the Silicon Detector Facility at Fermilab. So this is a virtual tour of SIDET. And I'll first give you a very brief history of SIDET and describe SIDET's facilities, and then describe the types of science that are supported by SIDET. This is a map of Fermilab, and for a scale, I like to use the 4-mile circumference of the huge Tevatron accelerator ring. SIDET is located about 1 mile away from the Tevatron ring. So most of the areas on the site, the site is, supports much physics and astrophysics, but you'll notice that a lot of the colors on this map are green and blue. And that's because Fermilab has huge area that are natural areas. There are wetlands and forests and prairies and lakes that support a lot of wildlife. In fact, there have been a total of 291 bird species recorded at the lab. So it's quite a beautiful place to visit. Here's an aerial view of the lab showing the location of SIDET. And this ring is the 4-mile ring that I had marked on the previous slide. So in the early days of Fermilab in the 1970s, the accelerator operated in the mode where it accelerated protons in this ring. Protons were extracted and hit a target underground about here, producing a huge variety of particles where the mesons were sent to this area, the meson facility. The protons were selected to the proton area to hit targets in the proton area. And the neutral particles, especially the neutrinos, were just let go straight ahead because you couldn't bend them to the neutrino area, which is where SIDET is now. And at that location was this 15-foot bubble chamber. And this was the target for the neutrinos. When it was operating as a detector, it was underground right about here. So I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute or two, but first I'll point out the different areas at SIDET. So these two buildings house clean rooms that are used for detector assembly, detector testing, and wire bonding. Under this cool geodesic dome, which is a 20-ton crane and a large assembly area that's been used for many projects throughout Fermilab's history. And I'll show you two projects as they're constructed under this dome. Here on these two areas are lots of lab spaces and offices. And this area is where much of the engineering goes on. So back to the bubble chamber. The bubble chamber used to be underground here. And when it was underground, it looked like the image on the left. Now, bubble chamber has been removed and now it houses the Axion dark matter experiment, which you'll hear a little bit about more a little bit later. So in 2004, it was decided to take the bubble chamber out from underground because it wasn't being used, hadn't been used for quite a few years. And it's so cool looking, just put it on display in the middle of the courtyard at Fermilab or at SciDET. So these images show the raising of the bubble chamber and moving it to the courtyard. And this is how it looks today. And it is really cool. My office looks right out at the bubble chamber, and it's just something really, really cool to look at every day and to think about that history. And here you see again the geodesic dome in the background, which I'll be talking about several more times. So the history is from 1969 to 1988, at SciDET, it was kind of the bubble chamber era where most of the efforts were to supporting the bubble chamber. But in the mid 80s, silicon detectors were being rapidly developed and improved and became preferred for high energy physics experiments. So the bubble chamber fell out of favor and detectors started being developed that were based on silicon detectors. So the silicon detector area is from the 1980s till now, through now, for high energy physics detectors, imagers such as charge couple devices, dark matter detectors, which could be based on charge couple devices and many other silicon detectors, and many more detectors. But we also now work on a lot of superconducting detectors. So I think we perhaps should change the name of SciDET to SuperDET or something like that. And some of examples of the superconducting detectors are those used for the South Pole Telescope, which are intimately related to the detector Sarah was just telling you about. MKIDs, microwave kinetic induction detectors, are another type of superconducting detector we work on a lot. Quantum sensors, for example, superconducting resonators, and many more. So SciDET has many assets that have been developed over the years. For example, there are many, many highly skilled technicians. We have capabilities of doing precision metrology for measuring the detectors and how they're placed on the structures that they're going to be deployed on, and experts in wire bonding. So on the left, I show, let's zoom in on some wire bonding. And we have clean rooms. We have class 100 and class 10,000, where that number reflects the number of particles per volume. So the smaller the number, the cleaner it is. So these images show people working in the clean rooms, and in the class 10,000 clean rooms, you wear a smock and hairnet and booties, but in the class 100 clean room where you would assemble devices that are super susceptible, or you really, really don't want any dust on them, like optical imagers, there you would wear much more clean room gear, like hoods and masks and booties and jumpsuits, and it's much, 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 much more protective gear. There's also a huge emphasis throughout SciDET on electrostatic discharge safety. And what that refers to is, especially in the winter in the Midwest, static is a big problem, It's annoying, as this girl on the left is experiencing as she's putting on a sweater and her hair is standing up. But for we who want to use sensitive detectors to do cool physics and astrophysics, it's more than annoying. It can, a teeny spark that you don't even hear or see or feel can ruin a device. So we're very careful to use proper grounding techniques, wear wrist straps, as you can see in this picture I have on a wrist strap as I'm working on some detectors in this cryostat. We use ionizers, as this device here that emits positive and negative charges to neutralize any static charge on devices. We use humidity control. If it's more humid, it's harder to create a spark. And we wear proper garments that you can't create a charge on. So we're extremely careful about controlling electrostatic discharge. Cited is involved in many, many projects, as I keep saying, high energy physics, astrophysics, and quantum sensors, and more. So in order to give you an idea of what it's like to start and complete a project at Cited, I decided to concentrate on some of the detectors used for astrophysics. So in Fermilab, we have the Cosmic Physics Center, which is kind of the center for the astrophysics projects. So in this 4-minute sort of tour, with tour in quotes, of Fermilab Cosmic Physics Center, you'll see many sensors that were packaged and tested at CIDAD. So let's take this tour.
Hello. Here I am working in the lab on a microwave electronics circuit. As an engineering physicist at Fermilab, I'm thankful and thrilled to have the opportunity to work both in the lab and in the field on cosmic physics projects. In addition, I often have the opportunity to share my enthusiasm with visitors. Here I am with two colleagues waiting for a tour group to arrive. Today, you are my tour group, and I'd like to tell you about the Fermilab Cosmic Physics Center. Cosmic physics is the study of the laws and contents of the universe. We use the distribution of matter and light throughout space as a gigantic laboratory. First, I'd like to introduce you to two projects that study the mysterious dark energy that is accelerating the expansion of the universe: the Dark Energy Camera on Cerro Tololo in Chile, and the Dark Energy Spectroscopic Instrument on Kitt Peak in Arizona. The sensors are the eyes of the telescope. The Dark Energy Camera sensors were designed and fabricated by Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, and then assembled, tested, and commissioned at Fermilab by people from across the international collaboration. The camera is comprised of 74 optical sensors. The camera creates digital images of distant galaxies that probe nearly halfway back to the Big Bang. Cerro Tololo is a great place for an optical telescope. The high elevation and proximity to the calm air mass rising over the Andes from the Pacific Ocean is essential to minimize atmospheric distortion, which can degrade image quality. The goal is to map hundreds of millions of galaxies and detect thousands of supernovae to find patterns of cosmic structure that will reveal the nature of dark energy. The Dark Energy Spectroscopic Instrument on Kitt Peak will pinpoint the location and velocity of 35 million galaxies by pointing an optical fiber at each galaxy. The high-precision 3D map will give us new clues about dark energy. Strong evidence suggests invisible dark matter comprises most of the matter in the universe. Super CDMS, Sensei, and ADMX are searching for the identity of dark matter. Unlike telescopes that benefit from high altitudes, many dark matter experiments benefit from being deep underground, shielded from cosmic rays and other background radiation, in laboratories like Snow Lab in Sudbury, Ontario. In fact, Snow Lab is as far below sea level as the telescopes are above sea level. Super CDMS and Sensei will be located in a clean room deep underground in Snow Lab. Super CDMS sensors, made of germanium and silicon, are used to search for interactions of weakly interacting massive particles that may constitute the dark matter observed in the universe. Sensei scientists are using innovative sensors called Skipper CCD to search for the lightest dark matter particles anyone has ever looked for. The Skipper CCDs are also useful in the field of quantum optics. Using a large magnet, a microwave cavity, and ultra-sensitive, low-noise quantum electronics, ADMX is testing the theory that galactic dark matter halos could be made of particles called axions. Now, I'd like to introduce you to the South Pole Telescope. Light from the first moments after the Big Bang is still traveling across the universe. This light is called the cosmic microwave background. And we've built a camera that is sensitive enough to detect it. The camera is comprised of 2,700 antennas searching for the faint microwave signals that can tell us about the physics behind Big Bang. We installed the camera on the telescope, which is just a short walk from the South Pole. This is me at the South Pole. The South Pole is a great place for a microwave telescope. Located 2,800 meters above sea level, it is very high and dry and cold. These conditions are optimal because water absorbs microwaves. At the South Pole, it is so cold that moisture in the atmosphere freezes out, providing an unobstructed path for the microwaves, which have been traveling for nearly 14 billion years to reach the telescope. The telescope continues to scan the cosmic microwave background 24/7. Thank you.
So that presented an example of a lot of detectors that were worked on and assembled at SciDET. So I'll go into a little more detail about the CCD-based detectors and then the construction of the camera for the South Pole Telescope at SciDET. So CCD-based detectors. The dark energy camera, as the video explained, is an array of 74 charge-coupled devices, and it's the instrument used to perform the dark energy survey. The images show kind of the path that the CCDs go through to be assembled and tested at Fermilab. So we get the sensors from on the left from Lawrence Berkeley Lab, and then we mount them on an Invar foot, glue them to a circuit board, and then test them in cryostats, as the third picture shows. And we test them like crazy. We test many, many more sensors than we need and pick the best ones. And we test them for things like quantum efficiency by shining light of many different wavelengths on the sensors. We test them for linearity. Do they give twice the signal if you shine twice as much light on them? We test them to see if there are any defective pixels. And then we pick the best of all of the sensors and put them on a focal plane as shown on the right. And in the end, we have, as shown on the right, the completed dark energy camera. So any semiconductor device can be damaged by sparks, as I mentioned, that electrostatic damage. But structures called metal oxide semiconductor devices are particularly susceptible because they have a dielectric that can be damaged by just a little bit of current flowing through them if you discharge a signal through them. And these charge-coupled devices are arrays of millions of these particularly susceptible MOS pixels. So we had to be super careful at SciDET not to damage any of these sensors. So our care in preventing ESD damage was essential to making this camera successful. And apparently we were successful because the camera's been observing for 6 years. So we're quite happy about that. In a CCD, a charge-coupled device, the charge can be created by a passing photon or particle. So the CCDs can be both particle and photon detectors. In the case of the dark energy camera, they're photon detectors detecting light. CCDs got their name from the way the charge, which is the signal, is transferred from each pixel to the readout register where the charge is measured and then digitized. Once the telescope, the camera was completed, it would be mounted on the telescope in Chile up at the top where the arrow says camera goes here. And for scale, there's a 6-foot man in this picture. So that ring where the telescope is going to be on is huge. But before we shipped the camera to Chile, we wanted to be sure that it would operate well. So we placed the dark energy camera in a replica of that top end of the Blanco telescope. We call this a telescope simulator that we built at SciDET under the geodesic dome. And the telescope simulator could tilt and rotate the camera just like it would move 24/7 once it was on the telescope in Chile. And that allowed us to verify the operation of the camera and all these different orientations before shipping the camera to Chile. So I'll show you a time-lapse video of the construction of the telescope simulator. I lost control of my cursor there. So once we verified that everything worked, the camera, when it was on the telescope simulator, for example, we wanted to be sure that the CCDs didn't move or shift as you move the telescope from one position to another, or that the nitrogen, which was used for cooling the chips, the CCDs, didn't float okay as you move the cables all around. So once we verified it was all working, we shipped the telescope, the camera, to Chile. And this is how it looks installed on the Blanco telescope, and as it looks today, as it's been observing for many years now. So DCAM was a huge success. And as I mentioned, we had studied these CCDs in great depth. And it was realized that they could be used for many other experiments as well, both as particle and as photon detectors. So just to quickly go over some of the places these CCDs are now, and these are all projects that were assembled at SciDET. There's the dark energy camera I told you about. There's, just a second, I have to get use of my cursor again. Okay, and so there's the dark energy camera, which is in Chile. There's an array of these CCDs used as a dark matter detector in Sudbury, Ontario. There's an array in Brazil that are studying coherent neutrino nucleus interactions called CONI. There's Skipper CCDs, which were initially tested underground in the Minos tunnel at Fermilab. And right now is the Sensei experiment, the sub-electron noise Skipper CCD experiment, is being assembled deep underground in Snow Lab in Sudbury, Ontario. The dark energy spectroscopic instrument, that's CCD based, and that saw first light last year, and that's on Kitt Peak. And we hope to also have these CCDs in space as we're working on DARKNESS, which is an acronym for Dark Matter as Sterile Neutrino Search Satellite. And that would be two of these CCDs mounted and flown in a CubeSat in low Earth orbit. So these CCDs have really gotten around the world and hopefully in space. And now a few words on the South Pole Telescope and how the South Pole Telescope camera was assembled at SciDET. So SPT-3G is its goal was to build a new third generation camera for the South Pole Telescope called SPT-3G. So what is meant by a camera? So like Sarah explained, there's on a telescope you need a lens. So here in this for the SPT-3G, this houses the lenses. We had the film is the array of superconducting microwave antennas, and the body of the camera was a new receiver that we had to make to house the film. Here's a cross section of the lens, and here is a stop motion video of the assembly of the optics cryostat. Again, this is under the geodesic dome at SciDET. And in the background, you can see the body of the camera that this lens will be mounted on. Here's the lens mounted on the body of the camera, and here the lens is removed so you can see where what I call the film or the array of superconducting detectors will be mounted. Here you see the detectors mounted. So after confirming that the cryostat was functioning well, the optics cryostat and the receiver cryostat, it was disassembled and shipped to the South Pole via New Zealand. Most cargo and people fly to the South Pole via New Zealand on C-130 aircraft. So from New Zealand, it's a 7-hour flight to McMurdo and then a 3-hour flight over the Transantarctic mountain range to the South Pole. And here it arrived at the South Pole, and the cryostat and both the receiver cryostat and the optics cryostat were assembled. But now what about the film part? So the SPT-3G sensors, which are these arrays of superconducting microwave antennas, similar to the ones Sarah was telling you about. Some of the details are different, but very similar. In this case, the wafers were of these antennas were fabricated at the Center for Nanoscale Materials at Argonne National Lab, which is about 30 miles from Fermilab. So we'd get the wafers from Argonne, and then we'd assemble them, as is shown in this exploded view, where you have a frame to hold the fragile wafer with all the antennas on it. And then you'd put an array of lenslets on top of that, where these lenslets are analogous to the feed horns that Sarah told you about. This is a different way of focusing the light onto each pixel. And then you'd carefully clamp them all together and have a finished package like this. When really doing it, it looks like this. You get the wafer from Argonne and carefully inspect it under a microscope. And you put it together, put the lenslet array on top, and then carefully align all those lenslets with all of the antennas on this wafer using fiducials that are on the wafer and on the array of lenslets using an infrared microscope. Then once that was done, you'd attach cables to each of the six sides. You'd wire bond them with thousands of wire bonds that look like this. And the pictures on the right show the wire bonding machine, the head, and on the bottom, the two state-of-the-art automatic bonding machines that we have at SciDET. Then they're ready for testing either at SciDET or for shipping them to collaborators who also participated in a lot of the testing of the SPT-3G detectors. And note they're mounted in a cryostat because they need to be operated cold at 250 millikelvin. So once they're tested, they were put in very sturdy boxes that are called Pelican boxes, and they're hand carried to the South Pole. So after the detectors and the people are all at the South Pole, it's time to assemble that detector array and install it in the cryostat. So I'd like to conclude with a fun time-lapse video of the assembly of the SPT-3G camera at the South Pole. Thank you. Hope you enjoyed that tour of SciDot. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Donna. It doesn't matter how often I get to see video footage of people working at the South Pole. It blows my mind every time. It's awesome. If you don't mind, in the interest of time, I want to transition to our panel discussion, but if people have questions for you in the chat, do you mind hanging out for a little bit and answering them in the chat?
Sure.
Sure. Awesome. So thank you. If anyone has questions for Donna, if you want to ask them in the chat while we transition to our next segment, you can answer them and she will answer you there. So thank you so much for giving us that tour of the work you do at SciDot. It's awesome. So for this next portion, if our panelists, if you can turn your cameras on so I know who all is here. Hi, everyone. So we have our moderator is one of our panelists, Avalesh. We have Lauren Yates. We have Yuan Yuan and Luciano. If you, why don't we go ahead and do introductions first? So Lauren, if you want to go ahead and introduce yourself and talk about the work you do at the lab briefly before we get to questions.
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. It's nice to be here. I am a graduate student. I'm currently working on my PhD at MIT, but I've been based at Fermilab for almost 3 years now. So this is kind of my academic or scientific home. I work on a neutrino experiment called Microboon, based here at Fermilab. And what we're mainly doing on Microboon is looking for possible evidence of a new type of neutrino, which would be very exciting. And I can talk a little bit more about that. I don't know if people have questions, but yeah.
Yuan?
Yes, so my name is Yuan Zhang. I am a research associate with the astroparticle department. So I work on this experiment called the Dark Energy Survey, also work a bit on the LSST, also another cosmic survey with the Rubin Observatory. So usually that means that at the lab, I use the telescope data that is located from Chile. We collect a lot of data together and then I would analyze the data to study the expansion rate of the universe. So that's what I do.
Luciano?
Hi, I work on a technical division. So we mainly make magnet and now we are also making accelerating cavity. I'm an engineer, electrical engineer, but I work on system, mainly the tools to build the magnets and the superconductive cavities that is the component of accelerator, used throughout the world, really. Right now, I'm personally working on a special type of magnet, which is the AC dipole, which is going to be used for the Mu2E experiment, which is an experiment looking for muon 2 electron conversion. And so it's a very challenging and interesting magnet.
And finally, our moderator, Abulash. And also, I'm going to give a shameless plug because he's giving our Ask a Scientist talk next month, too. So,
Hi, everyone. I'm Abulash. I am a PhD graduate student at Syracuse University. And I work at a Fermilab experiment called NOVA. So it's a neutrino experiment. In NOVA, we are trying to answer like few questions. So like just in a few sentences, if I had to describe my experiments, what we do is we have two detectors, near detector and far detector. Near detector is in Fermilab and far detector is in Minnesota. So we shoot one kind of neutrinos, and neutrinos come in three flavors. And as they travel, they oscillate from one flavor to another flavor. So we shoot a type of neutrino called muon neutrino, and we catch it in Minnesota, and we see how the neutrinos oscillate. And we see the difference. Along with this, we also see, shoot anti-neutrinos and see how they behave. So we are also like, so it's a parameter called delta CP or charge parity violation. So in that we study what is the difference between neutrinos and anti-neutrinos. That's one question we are interested in. And we are also interested in how, regarding the mass of the neutrinos, some of the basic properties of neutrinos. Yes, so there's like a lot of things to say, but let me know if you have any questions on the comments, or I'm happy to answer about it.
Yes, so if you, we have a wide variety of expertise here. I have had some people email me in questions ahead of time and also send them in the chats just as a direct message to me, but please feel free to ask any questions. I know that there's some Saturday morning physics students on here, so if you have questions about the different career paths, this is also a good time to ask those. One question that I think might have been missed that maybe Yuan you can answer from earlier, it says, Alan asked, black holes can bend light. Can you tell that the light has been bent?
Can you maybe repeat the question?
Sure. So he's asking about how black holes can bend light, and how is it that we can see, I think, Alan, please rephrase the question if you need me to. How can we tell that the light is being bent, basically? What do we see in our telescopes and our experiments?
So I think I'm understanding this question. So asking about a phenomenon called a gravitational lensing. Mm-hmm. That means if you have something that is very compact and very massive, then, you know, any light that is passing, like, you know, you have something here and then there's some photons that is going in this direction. So when you have light passing near this object, the light will be bent slightly. And then when you are looking at the light from the original sources again, there will be some effect called gravitational lensing. When we observe that, actually it usually results in some features called, sometimes if it's strong enough, you would see something called the Einstein arc. That means the original light source, maybe it's a star or maybe it's a galaxy, but instead you will see it being stretched like into kind of having some sort of like round arcs. So when you see that, it's almost certainly a gravitational lensing effect. So that's actually very rare, but astronomers have observed a lot of that. So that's one sure sign of gravitational lensing. It's almost like placing a magnifier right in front of a galaxy or star image. So you see that the image gets distorted a bit. I hope that answers.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you. We do have a question in the chat from Brian. How do you know that you will hit the target in Minnesota for the neutrino experiment?
Yeah, I think I can take this question. So neutrinos are like particles which interact very rarely. They just pass through Earth as if there is nothing. So what we do is in Fermilab, we produce neutrinos and we shoot those neutrinos like in a wide angle, okay? And in a general direction of Minnesota. So, and in a far detector, we have, so we don't send the neutrinos continuously. We send them in like pulses. And whenever we send that pulse of neutrinos, and that is, we know exactly with the GPS system, what is the time difference and everything. So we can exactly calculate how long it will take for neutrinos to go there and when to collect that data. So when we shoot those neutrinos and we collect the data at that particular time, whenever we shoot, we can actually see those neutrinos coming through in our far detector. And it comes in a particular angle and it comes in those pulses that we send. So we can tell these are the neutrinos that we are being shooting in the Fermilab, because when we don't have beam, we see the neutrinos going in, we don't see as many neutrinos going in that direction. So hence we can tell it is coming from those neutrinos which we shoot from the Fermilab.
Great. I have one that was submitted in advance. It's actually for our engineer on the call, Luciano. What's the hardest engineering challenge you've had to solve? That's probably a hard question. Oh, you're muted.
The you muted is the phrase I heard the most in the few months. So, yeah, I'm not sure, you know, how to answer. I think myself, maybe like I talk by myself, of course. Maybe like 10 years ago, we resurrected a welding machine which was used for actually the making the magnet for the, now they're working for the LHC, and that was an old machine and was used only temporarily for a few magnets. And so the budget was limited and the machine was incredibly complex because it has many, many detail and things that were obsolete. So we had to come up with solution on the fly with for all the objects that were working on the machine. I think there was nothing really challenging per se. What was challenging was the quantity of little problem that we had to solve. Like I say, 20 challenging engineering problem, probably, you know, from the movement, the feedback of the current, the voltages and the welding machine, the starting, the gas, the cooling, the whatever. So that was actually, I had fun doing it. To be honest, at the end, when this machine worked, it was beautiful. It's a four torch going simultaneously. And just, I have to say this, when it works, it's really beautiful. Another challenge was when we made the robot for washing the cavities. We made three now because they were very successful. They cross communicate and it was cool. It was the early day of the internet, so we had to learn protocol. So that was a different challenge. Yeah, as an engineer, I have to say is the variety of problem you find on your plate almost every day. So yeah, I hope it helps. I don't know.
That was great. Thank you. Lauren, I don't know if you can speak to this or not, but how does neutrino research relate to cosmology? What are some of the things that we're looking for with neutrino research?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So Neutrinos are really interesting because they're really, really weakly interacting, but there's also a lot of them. As far as we know, they're the most numerous massive particle in the universe. And so even if they're really, really light, if you have that many of them, their sort of cumulative effect still matters in terms of shaping the way that the cosmos will develop between, you know, the Big Bang and now. And so by trying to understand the properties of neutrinos and exactly how many species they are and how they interact with some of the other particles, sort of fundamental particles that we know about, we definitely learn about how the universe could have or should have evolved. And there's actually an interplay there. So like, you know, as we learn about potentially discovering like a new type of neutrino, that would feed back into some of the stuff that people who are primarily like astrophysicists and cosmologists think about. But likewise, actually, neutrinos are so light that we basically haven't been able to measure their mass in the lab yet. But if you look at cosmological models, you can kind of put bounds on the neutrino mass, because like, if they were more massive than that, we would see basically their fingerprint on the universe in a different way, and we don't. So some of the best bounds right now on how massive we think neutrinos are, which again is really, really tiny, actually come from cosmology, not measurements that we've been able to make in sort of Earth-based experiments in the lab, although we're working very hard on that too. So it's all trying to get fundamentally at like, what is everything made out of and how did it interact so that we all got here today? Just different perspectives on that. So it's yeah, there's definitely some interplay. Maybe, I don't know if anyone else wants to add to that, but.
Okay, does anyone else want to add to that? No. Okay, so I have a question from Michelle. I'm not sure, I think I'm going to ask this correctly, but Michelle, please correct me in the chat or raise your hand if you need to clarify. She's asking, did you major in physics to study these effects, or are other branches of science such as chemistry also applicable? I think that's probably related to the work that you're doing now, as did you major in physics, or were there other things that you needed to study or other areas that might also apply? So Lauren, why don't we start with you and then we'll kind of go down the line with everybody.
Yeah, sure. So my bachelor's degree is in physics with a minor in mathematics. My PhD will be in physics, specifically experimental particle physics. I would say that I think like myself and most of the people that I work with day to day, their background is in physics, but we do learn a lot of stuff along the way. So for example, in the type of detector that I work with, basically one of the signatures of particles traveling through that detector is light, but it's light at a wavelength that's kind of hard to detect. So we end up using an organic molecule called tetraphenylbutadiene. we call it TPB for short, to shift that light into a wavelength that we can then detect with more conventional photon detectors. So there's definitely some chemistry in that. There's also definitely some kind of, I don't know, almost like material science in figuring out how to incorporate that molecule into the detector in a way that we could use it. And that's just one example. There's plenty of other, you know, ways that chemistry and material science and different things kind of come together, engineering obviously, to make these experiments possible. But you can always learn it. So like if you need something, you find a chemistry friend and you learn a little bit from them and you go learn a little bit more and then you learn and it's great. And I think that's true of kind of any field of research, but maybe particle physics in particular, where we have these big experiments that are sort of these complex things. Yeah.
Yuan Wen?
Yeah, so for myself, I also majored in physics, so to study cosmology these things. But I also admit that I had to pick up some additional skills. So I took a lot of classes with the mathematics students when I was an undergrad student, and I took some classes together with the statistics students when I was a graduate student. So I kind of like picked up mathematics skills and also statistics skills along the way. So you have to learn about those. And on the other hand, I admit that I actually skipped one of the main courses for physics students, which is called quantum field theory. So you didn't really have to do that in order to become a physicist. I think if you want to study some physics research things like cosmology or neutrinos, like majoring in physics is probably the easiest way forward. But you should be prepared to pick up some additional classes, courses, or skills. And I also know people that actually become physicists or study physics phenomenons, but they majored in chemical engineering. And one person had a business degree and another person had a statistics degree. So if you do major in other things, you could still become a physicist. I think there's really no absolute way of saying that you must do something. But yeah, I hope that helps a bit.
That was great. Abulash, go ahead.
Hi. Yeah, so my story is a bit different. I graduated in my undergrad is in engineering. I was an electronics and communication engineer. And then I worked for a little bit in an engineering company. And then I transitioned to physics. So mainly, I feel like in the experiment, at least I do in Nova, like it is like heavy on physics and engineering, and there is like a lot of chemistry too. Like initially when we set up the detector, we had to understand like, so Nova experiment is basically we have like PVC pipes filled with hydrocarbon liquid, like a hydrocarbon liquid, and it is filled with pseudocumin. It's like a chemical, so that there is, it makes the light, the scintillation better. That means whenever a particle passes through it, it can produce light. So all those expertise, I think, had to come from chemistry. And like now, whatever other things we do, there's like a lot of engineering involved as well. Like I explained with the experiment where we have two detectors and we need a GPS to sync the timings, and there's like all of these things are like very engineering heavy, and also like a lot of physics heavy as in you need to understand everything, how each of these things work, and then you'll be able to accomplish like a common goal. So I feel like it's really like a very interdisciplinary with the main focus on physics and engineering. Yeah.
Luciana, do you have, you want to talk a little bit about how that works and also maybe how the engineers and the physicists work together?
Yeah. Well, you know, we have many common education. I have a master. I'm not PhD in engineering electrical. And my career started a long time ago at this point, 25 years ago, more. But I worked in industry, first in Italy, where I come from originally, and then I moved to US for various reasons. And I came to Fermilab as a regular engineer, as a regular company, and I wasn't even planning to stay that long. Spent 20 years, really enjoyable experience. Working with physicists is So as seeing from the engineer point of view, I do not do physics. It's a lot of fun seeing the different idea interact. I feel there is a lot of advantage into seeing different point of view, and I really enjoy the respect you get from the physicist, and because we build their stuff, and also the respect you give to the physicists, because they know what you're talking about when you have problems. So it's been enlightening. I really enjoy it. Yeah.
That's great. I haven't seen any other questions come in the chat just yet, and I know we're running short on time, so I'm going to add kind of answer this as a wrap up. So what is it about, like, what result, what project, what experiments are you most looking forward to from Fermilab? What are you most excited about seeing in the future? If you want to start with Gianna, since, and then we'll kind of go down the line.
Well, obviously, the mu2e, especially if we see some signal. if we see the muon becoming electron, that I'd be really excited. But I'm sure Lauren would be very excited, and Abish especially would be really excited. So if we see some signal of not standard model physics coming from the muon conversion at very low level, which we might, that would be really exciting. So yes, first of all, the mu2e. Well, since I'm an engineer, a challenging experiment will be build a muon collider. So that's my pitch. I would like to see a muon collider built, because it's challenging from an engineering point of view, very challenging. So I think it could progress the knowledge of material and physics and so on. So that's my pitch.
Lauren, do you want to go next?
This is a really hard question. There's a lot of stuff that I'm excited for. I didn't mention this at the beginning, but I actually worked on mu2e for about a year when I was an undergrad. So I still have a little bit of attachment to that as well. I'm very excited for the mu2e results. Microboon is also planning to bring out our sort of the first generation of our flagship results in the next few months. That'll be the main result that goes into my doctoral thesis. So I'm really looking forward to that, both because it's exciting for the science and because it means I get to graduate. And another thing that I think is really interesting that I'm very excited about from a scientific perspective is a lot of the work that Microboon is doing and that some of the other sort of experiments that are currently under construction at Fermilab will be doing is trying to understand a lot more about how neutrinos interact with nuclei. It turns out we've been trying to address that for decades and we haven't figured it out yet, not completely anyway. And that is really the key both to a lot of neutrino physics so that we can sort of understand what we're seeing in our detectors. There's also a lot of interesting nuclear physics there. So like, how do nuclei actually work? Like, you know, many people know that like nuclei exist at the heart of an atom, but there's a lot that we actually don't understand about what's going on in that nuclear system. And that's obviously just a very like fundamental scientific question. So I'm excited for that as well.
Ren, can I go next?
I'm obviously excited about the cosmology experiment, SPT, or the LSST at Rubin Observatory. But I think I also have a weak spot for the neutrino experiment, like DUNE, because it's supposed to like, you know, it's where like the neutrino experiment and the cosmology experiment would start sharing, they could start observing each other's targets, and it's supposed to bring a lot of exciting things, you know, connect the cosmological studies of neutrino to the actual neutrino studies. So I think I have a personal weak spot for that. You know, I get excited easily.
Awesome. Go ahead, Avalash.
One question I'm very interested about is like, what is the difference between matter and antimatter? So in our universe, everywhere we see everywhere matter, but where did all the antimatter go? So this is like very interesting question to me. So there are like NOVA, the experiment I'm working on, we try to find like the parameter is called delta CP in like a fancy word, but it's mainly seeing what's the difference between matter and antimatter. And so the we have some sensitivity for that, to measuring that. But the coming experiment, DUNE, is like going to be really sensitive, and it's going to be like the hope is that the DUNE will answer that question to understand what is the difference between matter and antimatter. And it's also going to be very sensitive to see like very low energy neutrinos that might, so we might be able to like see very interesting things, what's happening around the universe. So there are, and also like another experiment I'm interested in seeing what they will find out is Ice Cube. So Ice Cube is basically an experiment where they stuck like photo detectors inside the ice in Antarctica, and we see like see high energy neutrinos coming from different directions in the universe, like supernova events. So all these things are like, I find them very interesting.
That's awesome. Thank you all so much. So that concludes our virtual Ask a Scientist. Thank you all for joining us on this Sunday afternoon. I also want to thank our speaker, our moderator, tour guide, and our panel of experts for sharing information about their work and answering our questions. The next virtual Ask a Scientist is going to discuss the science behind some of your favorite physics experiments. That takes place on February 14th. And it's also part of our bigger online family open house, which will be taking place February 10th through the 14th. I've put the link to the registration for that in the chat. Please sign up and join us next month for that. It's going to be great. I'm also going to share the registration link on our Twitter and at our Facebook accounts at Fermilab Ed. And please, you know, join us again. Look for information about our online open house. And I look forward to seeing you all on Zoom next month. And thank you all to our panel of experts, our tour guide, for being here. I really, really appreciate it. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.